Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. If you remain standing, we have Bob Barnett, our police chaplain.
Heavenly Father, we begin this evening by inviting your presence to fill this place. We're always dependent upon your wisdom, Lord, to be displayed through our leadership. We ask your blessing upon our city, especially on those that serve our community so well and those to be honored tonight for things they've accomplished. And Lord, we'd be remiss tonight if we didn't think of the many communities devastated by Hurricane Harvey. We bring them before you. We're thankful for their leadership and ask that you would grant them wisdom as they are rebuilding and being restored. And Lord, let this city, our city, always be known as a city that comes together and works together. In the name of the Lord, amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. I believe we have folks here from the World Alzheimer's Awareness Month activity. Jackie, Mark, please come around. I'm going to have Jackie say a few words here in a moment, but first let me just tell you that we're doing this to try to bring awareness to Alzheimer's as a disease. It's a really, really deadly disease. It's the third leading cause of death here in Orange County. It's a disease that's irreversible, and it destroys people's ability to think, to remember, and eventually even to carry out simple tasks. And, we have a very strong outreach and advocacy group here in Orange County. And before I present this proclamation to Jackie talking about how we're trying to make this the World Alzheimer's Awareness Month all around the world, let me have her say a few words, please, about what they do.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Mr. Mayor and members of the council, there are packets in front of you that just include information about our organization. So my name is Jackie Mark, and I'm the Outreach and Advocacy Manager with Alzheimer's Orange County. And this cause is very near and dear to my heart. My grandmother was diagnosed in 2015, and it's hard to say that the last grandparent I have will die with the disease. On behalf of Alzheimer's Orange County, I want to thank the mayor and members of the council for the city of Santa Ana for acknowledging September as World Alzheimer's Awareness Month. Today, there are more than 84,000 Orange County residents and 47 million people worldwide living with Alzheimer's disease or another form of dementia, and that number will triple by the year 2050. Since 1982, Alzheimer's Orange County has been the county's largest local nonprofit organization dedicated to providing free education, support, and advocacy to people and families living with memory loss. We are so grateful for your help in raising awareness about this devastating impact of Alzheimer's disease and invite you to take the first step toward a dementia-free community by participating in a Walk for Alzheimer's. The Walk for Alz is the county's largest community event to raise awareness and bring us one step closer to finding a cure. Each year, over 10,000 people come together to participate in our Walk for Alz, uniting the entire community in the fight against dementia. We encourage you to get ready and get registered by visiting www.alzoc.org/walk. And if you or anybody you know is affected by memory loss, whether they receive a formal diagnosis or not, please reach out to our organization. We provide free programs and services, and we exist to serve you. You can call our free 24-hour helpline, which is 844-HELP-ALZ, and we have bilingual services available. Again, thank you, Mayor and Council Members of the City of Santa Ana, for joining Alzheimer's Orange County as we recognize World Alzheimer's Awareness Month.
Jackie, let me just take a moment and present this to you for the fine work that you do. Unfortunately, this disease is just, you know, it's invisible in a way. You know, you can't see a broken leg or, you know, blood or anything, but it's people that all of a sudden just are not able to function. And it's not just the patients, but the families, the caregivers, they suffer a lot as well. So we're with you as we, you know, continue to figure out how to fight this disease. I know Dr. Eamon David here in Orange County. You know, he does a lot of brain images, trying to find out early, and then, you know, nutrition, oxygen, all sorts of therapies. Whatever we can do, we've got to do it to try to help prevent more people from getting this form of dementia. Thank you for your fine work.
Thank you
Jackie.
So
and Jose Solorio, you're next. Start coming, walking on down.
Oh, it is?
Our illustrious Councilman Vince Sarmiento, and after that, I think, Jose.
He's got the next five. He's got the next ten.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And was it Kelly with Alzheimer's? Not sure, but we want
Jackie.
Thank you. You do great work. I know a lot of families, unfortunately, that have to deal with that, and I know it's challenging work. So thank you for being an advocate. I have the pleasure of recognizing somebody who's visiting us from out of the country. She comes to us from Villa de Ontiola, Toledo, in Spain. So can I have Kelly Gabriel Rivera join me up here in the podium and? Let's welcome her with a big round of applause. She's coming all the way from, like some of us say, la madre patria de España. So it's great to welcome people into our city, especially folks who aren't from around here and get to know a little bit of Southern California. They get to see Orange County, and of course, they get to see our beautiful city. So it's always great to welcome people from abroad. And Kelly has a great story because she comes to us from, first, she was born in Santa Cruz, Bolivia, and she went to go study in Madrid. And she didn't realize that while she was studying there, she was going to fall in love with the country and become successful and study political science and realize that that was her true calling, and she ended up moving to a town 45 minutes or 45 miles outside of Madrid, and she realized her calling was serving the public, and she ended up running for city council there. And she tells me that Villa de Ontiola is got an 11-member city council. So she was telling me, and they have a pretty small city relative to ours. I think their population is about 8,000. I told her, holy cow, if we had 11 council members for 8,000, it'd be, you know, this would be a much more exciting meeting, I bet. But seven is enough for us, so I told her there's enough excitement. But we are sharing a lot of our different experiences, and let me just give you a little bit of background on Raquel, Kelly. Raquel is proud to serve as a council member for the Villa Antigola, Toledo, Spain, and her areas of focus are social welfare, environment, health, and employment. She engages with local businesses, and she does something really unique to what we do here. She ensures that businesses that do work with their city hire their residents locally. And I see Gil Davila in the audience, and he knows that we're always big on local hire here, so that's a great thing. One of Raquel's biggest initiatives is to prepare residents for work and help them with their interview skills and resume writing. So she has a small enough town that she can reach out and work with a lot of them individually, and she's always been part of that effort to engage those that are less fortunate. And so that's always a good thing that we try to inspire here as well. But another large movement, and I saw that it would inspire Raquel more than anything, is that she's involved in a feminist movement, because Spain, like many other, unfortunately, Latin American countries, are still very macho. And they're still very driven by males. And so she's been a strong advocate and a vocal leader for women's rights. And as a father of a 12-year-old daughter, I told her, thank you, because it's very important that we make those voices heard, and we continue with the advocacy. We're making better strides, but we're still not there, and we still have a long way to go. So I want to thank her for her efforts there as well. And she works closely with her healthcare providers to host free health screenings, which we always try to champion here as well, and work with residents and make them aware of illnesses early on so they don't have to deal with catastrophic problems later. And she secures bus transportation for those residents to get to those fairs. Most importantly, we want to applaud efforts that we see not just in our area, in our state, in our country, but celebrate those noble public servants that do good work all over the world. And I think the council member here is one of those. I want to recognize her family who's in the audience, and her aunt is a long-term friend of the city of Santa Ana, and she's one of my fellow compatriots from Bolivia. Cora Jackson, thank you for being here. So why don't you stand up and say hello and wave. And Ms. Rivera's daughter is here as well with a family member. Both of you go ahead and stand up, take a quick bow. Ahí se van, mira, levanten. Okay, voy a decir en español que se levanten y den un aplauso para saludar a todos. So I'm going to just say in Spanish, aquí también hablamos el español, no hablamos el castellano, correcto, pero hablamos el español un poquito más, más al lado de México que de España, entonces no hacemos la Z como se hace allá en España. Pero la verdad, lo que estoy diciendo es de que compartimos el apoyo a todos los que dan servicio al público, que lo hacen de una manera muy noble y tratan de abogar de los derechos y luchar por los derechos de los que necesitan. Y nosotros aquí en la ciudad de Santa Ana le aplaudimos y le apoyamos en todo ese esfuerzo y estamos con usted en todo. Y quisiera que nos den un saludo al público que está aquí presente, pero que también está mirando en la televisión. Y otra vez, bienvenida Santa Ana. Felicidades.
Buenas tardes. Good afternoon, everybody. Let me explain in Spanish, please. Mejor me comunico en español. Pues muchas gracias por este reconocimiento. Es un gesto muy bonito para imitar. Es un gesto muy agradable de sentirse, ya que uno se siente acogido y querido en un lugar tan lejano de su casa. Es muy bonito y lo agradezco de verdad. Y os felicito por el trabajo que estáis haciendo en vuestra ciudad, Santa Ana. Muchas felicidades y muchas gracias.
I just love to hear Spanish when it's spoken correctly, That just, it always stuns me. But I just want to say on behalf of the entire city, de parte de todos aquí de los residentes de Santa Ana y el Consejo Municipal que está atrás de mí, quiero darle este reconocimiento a usted, concejal Raquel Kelly Gabriel Rivera, reconociendo sus esfuerzos y sus contribuciones al ambiente, a la salud, al empleo de los latinos en la comunidad hispana en España. ¿Sí? Bienvenida aquí y le felicito mucho. Le esperamos y le vamos a ir a visitar allá en España también.
Por supuesto, estáis todos invitados a Ontígola, es un pueblo de Toledo que pertenece a Castilla-La Mancha. Estamos al lado de Madrid, a 45 minutos de Madrid. Estáis todos bienvenidos.
She says we're all invited to a party in her city. She's going to throw a big party with us.
Okay. Vamos a hermanar Estados Unidos con España, España con Estados Unidos, y cuando quieran a Bolivia también.
There we go. We bring our own, we get good sangria over there too, right?
Good evening, everybody. I'd like to invite up some of our great friends from TKO Boxing Club, Mary Lara, and some board members and volunteers, John Raya, Tish Leon, and someone else, but at least we have the two main folks. Come on up, don't be shy. They can be your photographers. That's what they want to do. I know a lot of folks here know about all the amazing nonprofits we have in Santa Ana, especially those that dedicate their lives to improving the lives of young people. And today I'm really pleased to, on behalf of our mayor and city council, recognize the TKO Boxing Club, their local nonprofit. They've been in Santa Ana now for 23 years. The program is a youth development program, a gang prevention program, and they really keep kids fit and out of trouble. Mary Lara and their great board, and also they have an amazing trainer who unfortunately had the flu today, Hector Lopez. He couldn't join us, but together they've done a lot for the commitment of these youth. Mary in particular, you know, really gives her life to TKO, and you know, those kids and that gym, you know, are her life and her passion in its entirety. And Hector, who is the main trainer, he's been there and committed for 21 years. I mean, that's a big commitment. It's 22 now. Many. And through their training, for example, they now have won 55 national and international championships. That's amazing. Let's give them a big round of applause for that. It's fantastic. And in June, they celebrated, overall TKO did, their 23rd year of offering this program. And this is one of the amazing things. It's run by an all-volunteer staff. This is essentially, when you're dealing with young people, especially teenagers, a lot of them are, I mean, this is essentially a 24/7 program year-round for 23 years with all-volunteer staff. It's simply amazing. In August, they also awarded their 11th annual Deputy Chief Bruce Carlson Scholarship. It's, you know, named in honor of a prior Deputy Chief that we had that was very supportive of this program. TKO has also produced, and we know there's going to be more in the future, but they've already produced 4 professional boxers, 2 of whom now fight for Golden Boy Promotions. Ronnie Rios is, you know, one of the more of famous students that came out of this program. And really, you know, we're here because they continue to have a packed house. They continue to look for support, volunteers, monetary donations. I know the city has helped in many ways, but, you know, we hope in the future the city can help more, because we know you've been there on the front lines helping, and we definitely need to do more. Very recently, 3 of their students also competed at the annual boxing show and won championship belts as well. One was, in fact, selected by all the officials as outstanding boxer out of 29 bouts. So on behalf of our mayor and city council, let's give TKO a big round of applause. And a few words from Mary Lada, their director and fundraising chair.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you on the City Council that have supported us throughout the 23 years. As Councilman Solodio said, I've been there for the 22 of those years, and at that time, I hated boxing.
She did.
I've never liked boxing, but I love the kids. They grow on you. And this year, we had a first. We had 2 dads that came in. I didn't even recognize them. They used to train at TKO when they were younger, and now they are bringing their kids to TKO. So we must be doing something right for the dads to bring their kids in now, and I just think that's just so special. I'm very proud of our club. I especially am proud that we are all volunteers. None of us gets paid, so we don't have to charge a monthly fee. We're jam-packed every night. I'm hoping that we don't have to start turning kids away, because we are so crowded right now. 50, 60, 70, 80 kids every night. So, you know, we do what we can with the volunteers that we have. And I think John has a few words to say.
Always. I wanted to just kind of highlight one other thing, though. We have tremendous success in the ring. We have tremendous success with the parents and the families of them. We have kids that are healthy now. We have a biggest loser competition. And kids come in, and over the course of 6 months, one of them lost 55 pounds training and learning how to eat right. So those are things. So this is about health as well. But one other thing, outside of the ring, as the councilman mentioned, we've been providing scholarships, seed money, I would call it, to some of these kids. So we have numerous young folks, boys and girls, first in their families, who go to SAC, Orange Coast College, Cal State Fullerton, Chapman Law, and Tufts University. So all our wins, all our knockouts are not just in the ring. They're happening outside. So thank you all very much, and thank you to the city for your support.
I have a very special presentation. I can guarantee you that I don't think anyone in this room has ever experienced what we're about to experience tonight. May I please have Kevin Nguyen come on up from the great Sagerstrom High School in Santa Ana, California. Come on up. As he's coming up, I'm going to explain a few things about Kevin. Kevin is a senior right now at Sagerstrom High School. In the spring of this year, Kevin enrolled in an after-school practice session and practice sessions, which he attended two times a week for more than a month to prepare for the ACT test. So if you're aware, in high school, you have the SAT and you have the ACT test. So different colleges look at either one. He did this knowing a high score on the test would give him a competitive edge when applying for college. The ACT is a curriculum-based achievement test. It measures what a student learns during his school years, and there are 215 multiple-choice questions. Those questions range from English questions, mathematics, reading, and science, and they also include an optional writing component. The ACT results are accepted by all four-year colleges and universities in the United States. What's interesting about Kevin, and the reason why he's up here, and the reason why we celebrate him this evening, is he took the test, he went home, celebrated, had a nice little meal, played some video games, and then a letter came to him. He opened up the letter, and what he found was he received a perfect score on the ACT. I've been teaching for 22 years. I've seen perfect transcripts. I've never seen anyone achieve a perfect score on an ACT. I mean, we're standing next to greatness here today. And to know that he's in our city, in our public schools, just makes it that much sweeter. So Kevin is current academic activities include 6 advanced placement classes. He's also with the planetary engineering class offered at Sagerstrom High School. He is in his final year of piano, and he is a member of the Key Club. And in his spare time, he enjoys reading, watching movies, and playing online games with his friends. So I just need to say this, that Kevin, it is a great honor to have you here with us today. I am so proud of you, and we celebrate with you, and what an amazing accomplishment. I'd like for you to tell us a little bit about what you plan on doing in the future, because I know those top-tier universities are going to come calling.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd just like to thank my parents sitting back there. They've really... every step of the way in my academic career, they've supported me, they've been behind my back, making sure that I get to where I need to be, and they support me when I'm tired, when I need help, and just when I need support. And as for my future plans, I plan to look into applying to UC Berkeley and possibly USC. And
one of our colleagues is from Cal, so he's excited.
And I'm thinking about maybe looking into a few East Coast schools as well.
Great. Yeah. Well, Kevin, first of all, can I have your parents come on up? While I present this, I'd like you to come on up and be up here with him as well. So, Kevin, in recognition of your outstanding achievement, obtaining a perfect score on the ACT test, we celebrate you here today in this great city chamber, and it's signed by the mayor, the city council, everyone here with us. So congratulations. We know you're going to do a lot of great things, and thank you so much for coming out. We're very, very proud of you. Congratulations. Can you take a picture? Let me move this down a little bit. All right.
Can I get a picture with the audience?
Sure. Let's turn around. This way.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Can I have Chief Black from the Orange County Fire Authority come forward? If you can give us a quick update on what's going on with our firefighters who went to Texas regarding the tragedy.
Mayor, Council, thank you very much for this opportunity to recognize some amazing work being done by amazing members and heroes of your Orange County Fire Authority Fire Department. The members of the Orange County USAR Task Force, the Urban Search and Rescue Task Force, are members of the Orange County Fire Authority, a couple members of the Orange and Anaheim Fire Department, along with numerous support personnel, including our favorite dogs and many doctors as well that support our members. The role of the Urban Search and Rescue Task Force is when they're called upon to search out, locate, and rescue and stabilize people that are victims of both natural disasters, such as the flooding in Harvey in Texas, and probably Irma. We'll probably be sending some to the East Coast here soon, but also man-made disasters as we saw in 9/11, as well as the Oklahoma Murrah building bombing. There are 28 USAR task forces. They are assets of FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency of the United States. They are fully funded by that agency, so they are no cost to us as an agency. There's of the 28, there's 7 of them here in the state of California, and we have the pleasure of being task force number 5. They are on August 24th when the Federal Emergency Management Team called. They responded to Texas. They responded to San Antonio, Texas on August. They arrived on August 25th, just as Harvey was arriving on shore. A day and a half later, they were one of the first 5 task forces that were deployed into the city of Houston. And to this date, they are just now being demobed and on their way back to the state of California. In that 12-day deployment, they did over 1,000 rescues. That is simply amazing work. That was 48 hours, the first 2 days, without rest of continuous operations. Several of those members of that task force are firefighters right here in your city, and I hope at some point here in the future we can bring them here and recognize them because they did some amazing work. Thank you. In concluding, I'd like to tell you one quick little story that they brought back to us, and we got some photos for you as well. But they took one of our boats with two rescuers, and they had to force entry into an assisted living home where all of the residents need help, kind of a senior living home. And they were all on the second floor, and our boat went inside the building to the stairs on the bottom floor, rescued four people in that home. On their way out, as they were turning the boat around inside the lobby of this assisted living home and started out, one of the elderly women became very upset because her cat was still upstairs. So our folks turned the boat back around and went back up there and got their cat for her. As they turned the boat back around and headed out, up walked a sheriff with a deer that had been swimming for 10 hours laps around the outside. So what did our folks do? They put the deer on the boat with four people and a cat, and they rescued all of them to high ground. That's just a little anecdotal story of how unroutine these kind of rescues can be. And I want to thank you sincerely, Mayor and Council, for giving us an opportunity to recognize some of those amazing people. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Councilor Villegas. I know you serve on that board, and you brought this to my attention earlier, and I think it was a fine recognition to make. So with that, Madam City Attorney, do we have anything to report out of closed session?
Mayor, we do have one matter reportable action. On item number one, the public employee appointment, the City Council intends to adjourn that item to about 9:30 on Monday, September 18th, on the 8th floor of City Hall. There was no reportable action under number two, items one and two, but I would like to note the mayor recused himself from the conversation regarding the Maria Gomez case out of an abundance of caution as he's had alleged conflicts. That's all I have to report.
Thank you. So with that, let me bring our attention to the consent calendar and ask if anybody wants to pull any items.
Mayor, may I make a quick introduction while your council is looking at the consent and making their decision? I would like to the council and the community to have an opportunity, Robert, would you come up, to meet our interim community development agency director, Robert Zierschmied. Robert started about 2 weeks ago. He has an extensive background in redevelopment. He's worked in many Orange County and Southern Los Angeles County cities, Deputy Director of Development Services for Long Beach, Director of Redevelopment and Economic Development in Fullerton, and Redevelopment Manager in Anaheim, just to name a few of them. And his areas of expertise are in redevelopment, affordable housing, streamlining of a governing board procedures, and he has worked a great deal with oversight committees and unraveling the situation that cities found themselves in after the demise of redevelopment. All things that we can use here in Santa Ana. He'll be with us for about 6 months or so. And I know I had said something out to the council, but I wanted you to see Robert, have a chance to know who he is, and I know he's available to the council anytime you might have questions on anything that CDA
Thank you for that, Madam City
Thank
Manager.
You, Mayor.
Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor.
Welcome.
Happy to be here.
Any questions or thoughts from council members?
Welcome.
Welcome. Welcome on board.
How do you pronounce your last name?
It's the easiest way. It's two words, Zierschmied. Zierschmied.
Okay. I go by the city manager had it wrong, so okay, Zierschmied. Okay.
Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, I'm going to call on one speaker, and then we'll take on the consent calendar. Peter Katz, you want to talk on item 25E? Come on down, sir.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. This pertains to benefits for employees in the city, so I chose this topic to just to say a few words of my support or the city employees that are negotiating a contract with you, you folks. I just want to bring to mind that I've lived in the city 55 years. These are hardworking employees. And in light of some of the things that are going on around the world, in New Mexico, a 16-year-old boy shot and killed two librarians. So, you know, not only do the police and fire put their lives on the line every day, but the city employees are out there too, and they need safety as well as fair and equitable compensation. And, you know, Vince, you talked a little bit about good work being done around the world. Well, right here at home, we have a lot of good work being done in this city, and I think that we need a fair contract for these people. So I wanted to just give my support to all of these employees, and let's knock our heads and find a way to make it work. Thank you.
Thank you. So that, I would entertain a motion on the consent calendar.
Mr. Mayor, if you could pull 19F, please, and I'm going to be a no on 19C.
All right. Would you make a motion on the balance?
Mayor, I'd like to pull 23D for a quick question of staff, and I'll second the motion.
All right. Councilmember Solorio?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I just want to note an abstention on item 25C. I believe one of the ambulance service providers is one of my campaign supporters. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, we have a motion, a second on the balance. Let's do that, and then we'll take on individual items. Those motion in favor, approved. Please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Madam Clerk, which was the first one? 19F.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. That was my item, and I just wanted to see if the city attorney could just walk me through this. I know that it's something that I'm sure she and her office have been working very hard on, because this is the these are the receiverships, right? So I saw that there's an enumerated list here of five properties, and I'm just wondering, I know the list must be longer than that, but how these first five were maybe selected. Was there a preliminary work done already on these?
We did. Councilmember Sarmiento, we work closely with our code enforcement division. We asked them to identify some of the more problematic properties. We also were looking for those properties in which we thought we could have a quick success. And so there was about a list of 8 to 10 of them. We are proposing the five that are here because that's the funding we have. The council had allocated $100,000 into a special fund to pay for these receiverships. We were actually able to negotiate an alternative fee arrangement with a law firm where the city's maximum exposure will be $18,000 per case. And if additional fees are incurred by that firm, then the firm can recover them through the receivership process. But if for some reason the receivership is not successful, then the city's maximum exposure is $18,000. So we're really proud of the way we've been able to structure this. And if we're successful with these five, we'll be back with the other five as well.
Great. Thank you. Great work. And I understand that we've been very effective, so I'm sure that we're going to be successful on these five. And I see Alvaro nodding his head yes back there. So one of the things I just would like to mention is there's a property I know that I've been called very frequently on. It's on First Street, and I think it's the old Saddleback, right across from the old Saddleback Inn. And we've seen a lot more activity, and it's a shame that Acting Chief Valentine isn't here. But I know First Street has been getting a lot of activity. Fourth Street, it's been spilling out into the residential area on Fourth. There's unfortunately a lot of folks doing what they shouldn't be. I know I've had to call for service at least 3 times from my property, and I think Julie knows that as well. And I've just had a number of neighbors just complain about now that area being the source of a lot of problems. And I know we're making a lot of improvements on First, but that really has been a decades-long problem. And if you can, maybe research with your team anyway that any residual monies are remaining, that that be high on the list. Thank you. And with that, I'll move the item.
Is there second. A second?
Second.
Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Next item, Madam Clerk. 23D.
Thank you, Mayor. That was my item. Just a quick question for staff. I'll be supportive of the item. What we're looking at here is some much-needed improvements, long-awaited improvements to the parking structures in our downtown, modernizing them, putting in new technology. And the main question is, can't get these improvements done soon enough. Appreciate staff for all the work they've done to bring us this far. Just wanted to get a sense of timing as to when we might start the work and when we anticipate the work being completed for these parking structures that will benefit both the residents, visitors, and our local downtown businesses as well.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. The construction takes 6 to 8 months, and the main reason for that is equipment that needs to be ordered and needs to be put in place, and that would be the critical timeline that takes that long. But we are aware that we need to push this thing, get it done as fast as possible.
Okay, so for first part of next year, first quarter of 2018, is what I...
That's true, if not earlier.
If not sooner. Great, perfect. Thank you again for your work on that and for expediting anything that can be done. Appreciate it. Thank you, Fred. With that, I'll be moving the item.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Clerk, you decide. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries unanimously. Next item.
We have two oaths of office for Andres Matzkin and Joseph Acevedo.
Why don't you come on up? Why don't you administer them at the same time? They're going to start the same term. Come on down. You can stand next to each other. And when she says, I state your name, just state your own name. And we'll go from there. And welcome to these two boards that you're going to be serving on. They're a great service to the city. Just stand right there in front of Maria.
I, Andres Matzkin.
Speak up.
Do solemnly swear to support and defend the Constitution of the United States
and the Constitution of the State of California
against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I take this application freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, that I will and faithfully discharge the duties which I'm about to enter. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Now, are we on to our business calendar? Okay, 75A. This is time and place for a public hearing, basically approving a zoning ordinance amendment number 2016-03 to amend certain sections of Chapter 41 of the San Municipal Code. And Ricardo Garibay, are you here, please, sir? Just go ahead and make your comment if you have comment, and we'll go from there.
Buenas tardes, señor Pulido. Mi nombre es Ricardo Garibay. My name is Ricardo Garibay. I'm the property owner of the, I'm the owner of the property on 1002 East 17th Street. And I am here to to support the measure, the item 75A, because there's been a problem with my property. I have a problem to get tenants for it, because according to the city regulations, I don't have enough parking spaces, which has never been a problem to me, because there's a lot of spaces in my property. So please, I'm here to support the mission.
Thank you. Thank you. With that, any other speakers? If not, I will close the public hearing, bring it back to council for consideration. Is there a motion?
I move.
Motion approved. Is there a second?
Second.
Any questions?
Question for staff.
Okay, we have a question. Go ahead.
The first recommendation there addresses wireless facilities, asking for the permits to be allowed to be extended from 5 years to 10 years. Just a question for staff on... there are certain requirements that we have, particularly for the essentially kind of having these monopines or different trees blend into the their aesthetics, into the surrounding areas. And I'm just wondering if there will be any type of monitoring or any if there needs to be any updates to the aesthetics, to the condition of these cell towers at times, how we would be able to monitor that. I know that the intent here is to not have to have them come back within the 5 years to be able to make it so that it's perhaps more of a bottom line, my main question is just, is there a way to, within 5 years, for it to be maybe an administrative review, just to look at the towers themselves? Just oftentimes the intent is for them to be to not negatively impact the aesthetics of the community, but in some cases, especially some of the older ones, in some cases, to become somewhat of a negative aesthetic. So if you can address that, that'd be helpful.
The conditional reuse permit has a condition that we apply to all cell towers that requires them to be maintained appropriate with their in good condition with the appropriate landscaping. So as in any other conditional use permit, if that did not occur, they could be enforced, code enforcement could be called, and we could ask for that to be reconsidered.
Okay, so long as there continues to be some type of action that neighbors other than the city can bring to city's attention so that we can pursue in case that there is some type of a blight or something of that sort that helps address. That was my only question, Mayor. Thank you.
All right.
Also, I think we have another question on the right. Are you done, Council Member?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I just wanted to, I know that the city manager and I spoke about this a little bit, and thank you, number one, for working with our planning staff and our building staff to get some of these improvements done. I know we've had several conversations both on and off the record that there's been some lag time and how can we make improvements, and sometimes it's as simple as changing the culture. Well, hopefully you're blending both of those, not just changing the culture at the front counter, but also making some mechanical changes that are going to help expedite some review. That doesn't mean that they're going to be less quality, that just means they're going to be quicker and more expedient, and unfortunately that's one of the things that we haven't been able to solve. But you know, I appreciate these changes because I think now we're more consistent with other cities, and sometimes when folks come and visit us, we have a tough time competing because our standards are so rigid and inflexible and really antiquated with the ratios that we have around us. So the only thing I was going to mention to you is I understand that there's a backlog of applications that exceed the two-week period that we normally tell folks that we can get their paperwork back on, and that's no function of our staff not working hard. In fact, they're working very hard. Is there a way that maybe we can augment and bring in some even temporary help through an outside consulting firm just to get ourselves back to where we should? We know that we don't have a permanent planning director right now. We'll be looking for one, but it'd be difficult to give them him or her a stack of work and say you're 8 weeks behind just as you walk through the door, and maybe we can kind of clear the plate a little bit and solve two birds. Well, your thoughts?
We have a backlog both in our inspections and in our plan check, and plan check is about an 8 week turnaround now, and what we try to work towards is 2 weeks. What we're doing is looking at the consulting contracts that council has approved for us to do accelerated plan check when developers want to pay for it or an individual wants to pay for it, and pushing some of our regular work to those consulting companies. We're moving slowly to make sure that they are doing quality work, but so far we've been very pleased with the work that they're done. At the same time, as we get that backlog caught up, we are also looking at our staffing, and we will most probably be back before the council asking for a couple of building inspectors. We're determining how many numbers yet, and we'll see if once we have the backlog on plan check done, if we need to make staffing changes there so our staff can continue to catch up. I just don't know that answer yet.
Well, thank you for that, and I hope that if you see the window of opportunity where we can maybe do a little bit more before those two, those staff positions come online, I think, this is the type of investment that we could make that would generate more revenue for the city. So these are opportunities that we need to take advantage of. But with that, Mr. Mayor,
I'm not sure if there's a motion.
I think there's a motion, a second. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Before we go on to the next item, I just want to take something out of order. Madam Clerk, do we have any members that wish to speak, reps from the SEIU in particular? While she's checking, if you're a speaker and you know you're going to speak, go ahead and come up, and then I'll call your name as you're up, just to save a little bit of time. Just come on up if you're a speaker, sit in the front row or second row, and just tell me your name and I'll call it out. Wayne Baker, come on down, sir. And then Melia Rios is next. Please go ahead.
I would like to thank all of you. I've worked for the city for a year and a half. It's a fabulous job. It's a fabulous city. Thank you for what you provide my family and myself. One of the big things for me was when I came here is my unit was severely understaffed, and we really have to work as a team to get things done and work together, and I work with great people. A lot of these people behind me that have worked here a long time have given back to the city and given it back a lot. And now we're asking you to give us 0.5% of the general budget in our negotiations. I think it's important that if you could view us as all the employees of the city as being on the same team. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Millie.
Good evening. My name is Millie Lugo Rios. I'm a senior librarian at the Santa Ana Public Library. I've been with the city for 11 years, and I hope you all had a very good Labor Day celebration. Because, you know, that was the creation of the labor movement, and it is done to accomplish and to constitute a yearly national tribute to the contribution of workers that have made to the strength, prosperity, and well-being of our country. Unfortunately, current bargaining negotiations have demonstrated that the contributions the city workers have made to the well-being of Santa Ana residents are unimportant and inconsequential to the city council, agency directors, and members of the city's bargaining unit. Falling revenues, major demographic shifts, and rising citizens' demands have become the new normal for city governments across the nation. We understand this. But if you want to deliver on your promises to provide high quality services, you will need to start seeing your employees as assets. Every city employee is a key contributor to the city's success. Every single one. Elected officials who treat their public workforce as anything less than their number one resource are missing the boat. City employees know firsthand the public's concerns because they're on the front lines, and they exhibit the exact depth of commitment to the community that you want and that you expect from them. And here lies our value. Our SEIU brothers and sisters are your most valuable resource. We make your promises to our community come true. Employee compensation can be an emotional subject, especially if you're an employee. Our union is a firm believer that compensation is a reflection of an employee's value to the city, and we have proven our value during the city's most difficult time. To put it simply, you're welcome. Thank you.
Gracias, Canales.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Katia Canlas, and I'm the Orange County Labor Federation Communications Coordinator, and also I'm here in support of SEIU workers. I was a former city employee, a nine-year city employee. I know how critical the role of the city employees in the city. We are the backbone. The city employees are the backbone of the city. There are your workers. There are your, from the janitorial, from the clerical, from the mechanic. They provide a significant and critical role in providing the services and connection in the community and your constituents. I ask for you to stand in solidarity with the workers. It is important that we show and acknowledge and appreciate the workforce. Please stand in solidarity with the workers. Thank you.
Thank you. Gloria Alvarado.
Hello, Mayor. Excuse my voice. We have been screaming all day long, supporting our immigrant workers out there, too. And it's a pleasure to be back in the city of Santa Ana and to see all of you out there serving. I want to let you know how proud I am of the city of Santa Ana. I'm a resident at 1429 North English Street in Santa Ana, Ward 5. And I can tell you that growing up in Santa Ana has never been so important to me as coming back to my town. And when I hear that SEIU 721 is going through negotiations and they are being treated perhaps as second class employees, it makes me wonder. As a former employee of 23 years, I know what respect and dignity is. I know you have shown that leadership before, and we are here to make sure that we continue highlighting that work. I just heard you state how wonderful it is to see our communities thriving and being happy because we are providing services. It is wonderful to see you speak of all the benefits that we provide to the community. Let me tell you, we wouldn't be so proud to do so without the employees. Everyone from the mechanics out there fixing our cars to everybody checking in with the after-school programs, all the recreation programs that we do, the staffers here at City Hall, making sure that every account is being paid and that we are keeping up with the requirements and the request of our community. It is important that we acknowledge their contribution. SEIU members, and as a organizing director for the Orange County Labor Federation with over 25,000 members, we are here in support of our brothers and sisters, and we ask you to please consider their proposals during negotiations. Thank you.
Thank you, Gloria. Gilbert, followed by Yvette.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Thank you guys for the work that you guys do every single day. It's hard work, and thank you guys for doing that work. At this time, can I have the SEIU members please stand up? Thank you. I'm the proud president of the Orange County Labor Federation, and I'm here to express my strong support for members of SEIU 721. I'm proud of them for all the work they do, and you should too. Many major decisions come out of the City Hall, big visions that you guys put out, and thank you for that. But the front lines is where the rubber meets the road, and that's where you'll find members of SEIU 721. When youth go to park and recreations department for after-school programs, they get those services from members of SEIU 721. When people from all walks of life go to the public library, they get the guidance they need from members of SEIU 721. When all the Santa Ana enjoys smooth roads and sidewalks, that's because of the hard work done by members of 721. And when all Santa Ana can count on the city's infrastructure working, that's because they can count on the members of SEIU 721. If you value your city, then you will value the city's workforce, because your workforce provides the front lines and city services. The public values Santa Ana's workforce. We know because they keep coming back and demanding more at the parks, at the libraries, and through requests for street services. Now it's time for the members of this city council to show that value Santa Ana workforce too. And it's time for the City Council to acknowledge an appreciation of the work that they do throughout the city. Restore the city services, invest in your workforce, and prove to everyone that City Hall cares about the quality of life for the people of Santa Ana. Again, thank you.
Thank you, Gilbert.
And thank you for your support.
Thank you. Yvette.
Good evening, Council and Mayor Pulido. My name is Yvette Portugal. I'm a resident of the city as well as an employee. The reason I'm here tonight is in support of the jail. I would like to see it filled. We are still paying on this jail. To sit empty means more money, additional money is coming out of our funds, funds that the city does not have. Mm-hmm. So I'm here in full support. Until we have an actual reuse plan, I think that we should be utilizing it. Thank you.
Thank you, Yvette. By the way, Yvette has the very best penmanship of any speaker here today. Nick Coled, followed by Alejandro Iva, I believe it is, maybe Vega.
Dear Mayor Pulido, honorable council members, good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to share some information with you, which I believe is important. My name is Nick Coliff, PhD, PE, civil engineer, 28 years member of the community, living for the last few years in the city of Santa Ana. On August 15th, I went to the police department based on the recommendation from the DA office and sheriff's department to file a claim for white collar fraud case. As a civil rights activist, I have more than 7,000 pages of litigations. I commented and criticized 10 judges for unethical behavior, violation of judicial canons, and 17 attorneys for violation of the state bar code. So I believe I know what I was talking about. I went that day to the police department, shiny building, nice new infrastructure, people well-dressed, looking professional. And I realized instead to take my complaint and to move it to DA office, they started to investigate me for 4 hours and 40 minutes. I got nothing. I was sitting there. They were waiting for their cameras, their system to pick up my biometric data to find out who am I. And finally, one of the supervisors for this emergency unit kind of making me a favor to come to his station and to talk to the Department of Child Support Services. I'm complaining about corruption involving them, and he's asking me to talk to them. It's like somebody complaining about police brutality or using of excess force.
Nick, you're out of time. If you can please conclude.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. So basically, I believe the police should do their job and just process the complaint. It's nothing which is involving resources or emergencies, just the paperwork.
Thank you.
I felt I was left down.
Alejandro Vega.
Thank you.
Si no, Alejandro, let's go to Lasher Rodriguez.
Is this public comment, or I thought we were just doing the SAU?
Well, she threw in a couple more. Blame it on the clerk.
Good evening, Council. My name is Lasher Rodriguez, and I am an advocate on behalf of Environment California. Environment California is an environmental nonprofit organization. And as a clean ocean advocate, I'd like to bring to your attention that California's beautiful coast is subject to expanded offshore drilling to gas and oil. We ask that the Santa Ana Mayor and Council join the long list of California State Senators, Assembly members, other City Council members, and mayors who signed in opposition to offshore gas and oil drilling in California. California's coastal community brings over $44.8 billion in economy revenue to California, as well as employs over 400,000 Californians. Again, we urge you to oppose offshore drilling, and thank you so much for your time and attention to this matter. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, I'm going to bring our attention to item 75, B as in boy, and ask the clerk, do we need to do anything on this
actually,
item?
Actually, just a continuation of item to the September 19th meeting.
All right, I entertain a motion. Moved by Benavides, seconded by Villegas. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye, those opposed, motion carries. 75C. This time, place for public hearing to consider an ordinance to regulate mobile food vending. I'm going to turn it over to our Mayor Pro Tem, which today is who?
We'll let David Benavides take it over.
David Benavides, you got it. Nominated by Councilmember Tina Hill.
Thank you, Mayor. You will be recusing yourself from this item. Is that correct? That's why you. So, Mayor will be recusing himself from this item.
And our acting mayor pro tem, if I just might mention that the mayor's recusal is based on an abundance of caution, as he's had alleged conflicts in the past and has decided not to participate.
So this is, we're on item 75C. This is the time and place for a public hearing to adopt an ordinance to regulate mobile food vending vehicles and direct staff to develop an electrical power options program for mobile vendors. At this time, we do have one speaker. And having opened the public hearing, I am going to call Richard Garcia to come forward and address the council.
Hi, City Council. I'm here on behalf of myself and the majority of the businesses here in the city of Santa Ana. We've been having issues regarding the lunch trucks. Due to the fact that they have out their chairs, tables, this is after hours when everybody's asleep. Sometimes I'm out there working, and on the way home, I got pictures. I've sent you guys pictures in February. That was the February 7th meeting, and you guys received them. And I also have more pictures that I will send you just most recently, like last week. So this issue continues to happen, and it has not stopped. So we definitely need an ordinance to pass. You got to think of the businesses that are on there. Just in the corner of 15th and Sycamore, there's three food carts there. And you had a young lady by Carmen speak at your August 1st meeting that it's encroaching over into her businesses. And this issue has not been addressed. So we definitely need this ordinance to pass. So the businesses can survive, especially the restaurants. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Garcia. Madam City Clerk, do we have any additional requests to speak or any correspondence that we have not?
I have not received any additional requests.
And we do have a correspondence that council has received, nothing additional to that, correct? At this point, planning staff is available to address any questions unless there are any.
I do have a question. If I could have Mr. Alvaro to come on up. The distinguished questions were asked about the measuring from schools. I know that we have that's part of the ordinance. I think it's 250 feet.
Right.
Correct. My understanding, you measure from the point of entrance. Is that
right,
correct?
That's probably, we're going to sit with the city attorney's office and do that as a, what's the most effective formal policy to do that. There was a discussion regarding the property line, mm-hmm. right? And so the idea is the safety factor, right? And at the same time, not to obfuscate any of the other issues. So as to not to take an advantage, what would be the most formal, efficient way to do something like that? And so would probably be the entrance of the actual school. Now, am I talking about the structure or the property line, right? In other words, if it's fenced, that's not an access way.
So I just to be on, before I'm cast my vote, I got need to make sure that I have this correct. Let's just pretend it's Santa Ana High School, okay? We don't go from where Santa Ana High School's property line starts, which is the grass area when you turn in on Flower. You would start in from the actual entry point, which is the front two doors of the school.
So when we discussed this issue, Councilmember Tina Harrow, what we were trying to address, we actually understood that some of the vendors were concerned about us measuring from the back of a school, because that's not where the kids exit the school. Mm-hmm. So I think what we were trying to solve for is how far away do we place the children who are exiting the school to the nearest vending truck. And so we would measure, in my opinion, we would measure from that point. Where are the children exiting? So if a high school had five different entrances and exits that the kids are using, we're not talking that are, you know, empty, but they're using, then we would measure from that point, because the intent of the ordinance is to not make these vendors easily available to the children right as they leave the campus. So that's how we would measure. That would be my opinion. We'd measure from those ingress egress points to the schools.
So I understand. You know what's going to happen is there's going to be a school that maybe allows for students to exit maybe in the front and then two back exits, right? So let's just say, for the sake of argument, a school says, that individual goes and says, look, I can't have my mobile vending truck here anymore because you're allowing students to come out of here. Can you please stop allowing them to come out of that back exit and only allow this exit over here and the front exit? And that school says, yeah, we can do that, right? Then that would be allowed, correct?
Yes. Remember that when staff originally made the recommendation to the city council, we just said, 500 feet from all the boundaries.
Line.
That was the staff recommendation, because from a staff perspective, that's easy to enforce, and we don't get the gamesmanship in terms of asking and making requests. But in order, as we were asked to go back and meet with individuals, the compromise position was the one that you have before you. We do believe, from an enforcement standpoint, of course, going back to the original staff recommendation works best. But as I said, in an issue of compromise, hoping to get this ordinance passed, the recommendation was altered.
Well, and I do believe we're moving the step in the right direction here, because it was a good compromise. It came with a lot of input from a lot of different folks. The only change I have today, because I always think we can make it better, right? I'm thinking about revenue for us as well, and I'm also thinking about our environment, and then some revenue, right? Because going green also brings a little extra revenue as well. I want us to bring it back. I'm going to go ahead and go forward and support this, but I'd like to make a friendly amendment that we come back in 60 days to explore green striping areas where those vending trucks have been there, and we can decide how many years, and charging an extra fee for the business license so that is their post. So that there's no issues later on with someone saying, no, well, I got here first today, right? So that we don't have issues like that, and we don't have to have service, calls for service and so forth. So that's one. I think that brings in extra revenue for the city with the business license. And number two is, my understanding right now is that if you have lights, right now most of our vending trucks are using generators, right? Which also causes, they have to spend for propane. They have to, it's also a pollution to the environment. So if we can have, plugs, from our light sockets down on the ground, where they also, that's their, basically where they gather their electricity, we can also use billing there for electricity as well. So I think that would be something that the city could do two things. We can go green on it, and at the same time, we can also make some revenue from that as well. It's not a whole lot of revenue, but it's something. My understanding is that one of the issues is that some of those lights don't belong to us.
Right.
Most of them don't. We are trying to purchase them. I was just going to say we can come back on that, but we probably in 60 days won't be back on the lights.
Okay.
That's going, our purchase offer is going through the PUC right now. And so that'll be more like January.
Okay.
So a little longer.
Okay.
But not much.
So, and all this is making it friendly. It's making it friendly for our vending trucks to be a part of Santa Ana. I believe, it's like I said before, when my friends went to New Orleans and they had a little po' boy sandwich and they had, some etouffee, and, they're showing their little, we have the ability to market ourselves as a city with our vending trucks, because they have some great stuff. They have some good food. It's tasty. Finger licking good. I could tell you because I like to eat. But I'd like to go ahead and welcome them and make that as part of our marketing tool here in the city of Santa Ana. So if we can make that friendly amendment and our council members could join me on that, I'd greatly appreciate it.
I'll second.
Councilman Tinajero confirming that was a motion. Councilman Tinajero second by Councilman Sarmiento, and I believe Councilman Villegas has a question or comment.
Councilmember Sarmiento, do you have any comment?
Just a quick second with comment, since Councilmember Villegas. I wasn't going to, but at the request, I'm just kidding. So I know staff's been working very hard on this, right. And I know we've put it over and over. And I want to thank Councilmember Tinajero for all the hard work that he's provided to this, and everybody in the audience, todos que están en el público. Gracias por tenernos paciencia y trabajar con nosotros y la ayuda. Sí. Las loncheras son parte de Santa Ana, y es algo que es algo que es. So it was funny, the other day I was in Long Beach and I saw these old crates that were turned into like restaurants, and I don't know what they called them, but each community distinguishes itself in a certain way, and I think the council member's correct. Santa Ana could see this rather than a hindrance or a detriment, they could see it as an asset. We could see it as a blessing. We could see that, you know, our people, look, are the reason why, you know, we have so many hardworking people in the city is because they do have to find a way to make a living, and, you know, they are, and it's an honest living. So what we can do to help make it conform to the community standards that are important to our residents and our homeowners and our businesses, then, you know, that's what cities do. That's what our function is supposed to be. So I just want to thank staff for working as hard as it has been. It's been a painful thing because, you know, this has gone through the courts, it's come back, and, you know, so public policy and laws tend to merge here. But more than anything, it's just working with our community and trying to find solutions to problems, and this is one that I'm glad that we're getting very close to. So with that, I'm going to support the motion.
Councilman Villegas.
Thank you, Councilmember Benavides. A question for staff. So so does this ordinance require for the vendor to have trash cans?
Yes.
It does?
Yes.
Okay. And is there a time limit on imposed on this?
Time limit on the trash can?
Where they can park.
No.
Wasn't there a time limit on there before?
No, actually, because part of the state requirements and the law, we can make certain changes as far as adopting local regulations, but they have to be attached to a public safety type of findings. And we couldn't find any of that, even with checking with Public Works or the police department regarding the hours of operation or time limits.
I see, because one of the chief complaints that I hear from the residents, wherever I go and they talk about the mobile vending issue, is that, you know, they're parked in front. And they're there
for a while,
yeah. And it's just, you know, it's not fair to them if we can't do something for them. But
no, I understand. The state code requires that as long as they abide by local regulations and business license and their public parking, as far as the vehicle code requires, then they can stay there.
Very good. All right. Thank you.
Councilman Solomon.
Yeah, I have a question and a few points, including a friendly amendment. We had a question from a constituent asking how this ordinance may impact homeowners associations or other complexes that have CCNRs. And I don't know that this ordinance would supersede those restrictions, but if for the record, if that could be clarified.
Yes, this ordinance would apply to all of our public roads. If there are any CCNRs or private homeowners associations that have private roads, they are free to adopt and enforce whatever rules they want to. These rules will not apply to private property owners.
Okay, very good. Thank you. That's what I thought, but I wanted to clarify that for the public since it came up. I, too, want to thank the patience of all the vendors have been working with us, and I think City Hall's listened, and so we made many accommodations. And I know the food truck vendors, in fact, have taken this opportunity to organize and professionalize, and they have a new association that they've named Santa Ana Food on Wheels Association. So let's give them a big round of applause for that. You know,
We now have one voice, one organization to work with, and it's going to be good for the association and good for the city and the residents. That's fantastic. Lastly, just a friendly amendment of some things that I know I've discussed with Councilmember Tina Heron and have come up. We'd, I think, also like staff to explore a good site for a food truck island, just kind of as a pilot program where there may be, you know, a vacant lot in the city that the city working with the association can explore having that. I know some cities, in fact, have, you know, taco truck festivals, and I think that would be a great thing, and that has come up. So that's really my only other friendly amendment to have staff do that. And I got a sense that there was some reluctance about coming back in 60 days or so. I think the idea is that the staff come back with a game plan. You know, we know that if, you know, lights and infrastructure and other things are involved, that it's going to take longer than that to implement, but we at least want a game plan. And I know that, you know, that there are some, you know, food truck vendors that they park in the downtown where there's a meter, and some pay like $4,000 to $5,000 in coins a year. That, you know, Councilmember Tina Harris is right that if they were able to get a designated permit area, you know, not that expensive, but some reasonable fee, that that would be good. And then that will free up parking in the evenings and early mornings when, you know, food trucks typically aren't there. So I think that's a win-win as well. But just a friendly amendment, just for consideration, that staff consider some possible sites for food truck islands.
So add that into the amendment that I put in before.
Correct.
So can
correct.
We do that, Madam Clerk? Okay. So do we need to take another first and a motion and a second?
No, if you accept the friendly amendment, you can consider the motion.
Thank you. Sounds great.
So to clarify, Madam City Attorney, we've had a motion with a couple of amendments. Can you just reiterate
second,
this?
If the motion, the maker of the motion accepts it, and the second, we can move forward.
Right, which you did. But just if you can clarify what the motion on the floor now, given the amendments.
I'm probably taking better notes on this one. There are three amendments that's to come back in 60 days with an update on areas where we might be able to put green striping that people could rent at a fee. Our vendors could rent at a fee. An update on where we are with the purchase of the electric poles. We know technically that we can make those poles available for electric power, but bring back to you where we are with having the poles as something that we control. And then also look for off-street lots, city-owned property, I presume is what you're talking about, Councilmember, where vendors might use them, so it, not all of the parking would be on the public right away, but some parking might be in private, publicly owned lots, but off the private right away.
And just to be clear, that would be as a supplement to what happens, not instead of any of the current spaces.
Thank you, Madam Interim City Manager. So we have motion and second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. Any abstentions? Motion carries unanimously.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Suarez. Mr. Mayor, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor Pro Tem. With that, Madam Clerk, what's our next item?
We have the Housing Authority agenda.
Ked, I would entertain a motion on the consent calendar for the Housing Authority.
Thank you.
There's a motion and a second. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Now, item three on the housing authority calendar, I'd entertain a motion.
Motion approved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Now, any comments from the city manager?
Just a couple of reminders for the council. We have some very important events coming up. The annual Fiesta Patrice Festival and Parade is September 17th.
Why?
We have a youth job fair that we're doing in collaboration with the school and the Building and Construction Council. The Work Center is hosting that on October 18th. And Savio Santa Ana is a chance for participants to sample food from over 400 downtown restaurants. That is on September 14th. Tickets for that are $10, and there's more information available on our website for anyone who's interested in participating. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Now, at the request of members on the right, they've requested that members on the left go first. So with that, let's start with Councilmember Jose Solorio.
You're left or they're left. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You know, and I know there's somebody from the public still here because we typically do public comment at the end.
I don't know when you turned it in or when you attempted to turn in, but once we start the meeting, after a while, we shut off comment.
You said you hadn't got to it yet. You didn't get the first one.
Yeah, I think we should consider him. He's a soccer league leader for youth.
He did try to submit a card after we had considered the other three cards we had received.
But that's because you did it early and you typically don't.
Got it. It was, all right, it was come on up.
Thank you.
Good evening. I was pretty patient. I thought, you know, I was going to get skipped over here, but I'm pretty big object to skip, so I thank you for your time. Back in 6 months ago, we had a groundbreaking ceremony or a ribbon cutting for Dan Young number 2 and number 4. And Mr. Solorio, you attended that. Excuse me, Mr. Sarmiento, I'm sorry. And it was well received by the soccer leagues. And we made comment to you about soccer field number 3. The dirt field, or field number 1, the dirt field. And then recently I heard that you guys sent something to the state and to the federal government got some money to put into another soccer complex. Well, Dan Young is our soccer complex, and it services probably 15 to 20,000 kids and adults a week. We got a grant, that's what it was, and we put the money into another soccer complex, so another city location that services less than 500 kids a week. When will somehow we put some money back into Dan Young to put either grass or a synthetic field in those other two fields? It's not fair to the public, for the youth leagues as well as the adult leagues to have non-standard fields. I was told by one of the city council people many months ago had said, let's leave the fields open. Let's don't shut them down and grow the Bermuda grass on those fields. We need the fields to be open. They're both dirt now. So it impacts everybody, well, health reasons as well as for just practical reasons. So I request you guys look at that, find some money somehow, if you can, and make these fields either grass or synthetic. It'll help the public and help all the leagues. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, Councilor Solorio.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do appreciate that. I want to bring up an issue that I've been hearing a lot in with this hot summer. It's kind of a harder situation, but we have many medians, and those medians have trees. We have apparently about 2,200 trees, I believe, in the medians, and you know, because of the drought and the mandate to not water medians with potable water, we have a big issue with trees dying, dead grass that we have to pay people to mow, an unfortunate situation. I did find out recently that there is a process through the state board to get a waiver from some of these mandates. I think they're called conservation orders. I know in the past couple of days, I have had a chance to mention it to our city manager, city attorney, and our water manager. So I do ask that we follow up with the state board on how to make that happen. I know we've been conserving a lot of water already, retrofitting what we can. We have excellent engineering and other plans and cost estimates to retrofit these medians, but we can't do them overnight. And you know, I've spoken to a couple of the board members that understand our situation and do want to be helpful in providing us some relief. So I would ask that staff follow up. I think another person in South County that received a waiver on a different matter, but on the broad mandate overall, is Moulton Nagel Water District. They've received some waivers in the past, so they might be able to also provide some informal suggestions on how to make that happen. But before more trees die, let's try to work on that. And I know in the meantime, staff does do a great job with the water truck, and they individually, you know, inject the water into each of these trees. But that is, you know, not really a good long-term strategy. So if staff could follow up appropriately, that'd be awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Villegas.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just want to say thank you to OCFA Chief Black for the fine report, the update in Houston of our people that are down there. Also, OCFA sent a strike team up to Latuna Canyon for the fires this weekend. There was two battalion chiefs. It was Henry and Morgenstern from Santa Ana who took the troops up there to help out and fight that fire, and I want to thank them for their dedication. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Benavides.
Thank you, Mayor. I do want to echo some of the comment with regard to that was made with regard to taking care of our urban forests or trees, particularly our medians. I believe we've had members of the public. Well, I know we have had members of the public to come and address us on that. I think a couple of members of the Environmental Transportation Advisory Committee, ETAC, city commissioners that have come and addressed us, and I've been in conversation with a couple of them as well. They have some ideas with regard to different types of watering, drip watering system, and others that perhaps don't use as much water, but at the same time maintain and preserve some of our trees. So and once we lose them, it's taken us years to be able to get some of these mature trees that do enhance our urban environment, and once we lose them, it'd be it's very difficult to bring them back. We'd have to start over. So I think it is in our best interest to do what we can to preserve the trees that we do have. This evening, we've had a couple opportunities to recognize and celebrate the diversity within our city, what our community brings. We had a young man here. We're celebrating him for his accomplishments. The city of Santa Ana and its diversity and all that we have to celebrate and its richness is in part and a significant part the fact that we're an immigrant community, an immigrant city, a city of immigrants, 80% of our population now being Latino, 50% being born outside of the country. I'm proud of the fact that that the city council, particularly in past years, has been a leader in standing up for our community. Years ago, we were one of the first in Orange County to join in support of the DREAM Act and of our DREAMers, our students who were brought here at a young age and celebrated with them when DACA was passed in the previous presidential administration. At this point, we're at a place where the future of our young people that are in this country, that have been brought to this country, and that have been working hard to educate themselves and contribute to this country, their future is being threatened by the current presidential administration. As we know, the threat has gone forward that DACA will be suspended. I know I've been in conversation with some of my colleagues here who've joined up together to take some positions of leadership on behalf of our community. And what I'd like to do is request that the next council meeting, we have an 85A item to address, not only condemn the action that the current presidential administration has called forth to suspend DACA, but to also call on Congress to act and act swiftly to once again reconsider the DREAM Act and to approve the DREAM Act to be able to allow for relief and to allow our young people to be able to become active, basically be able to come out of the shadows and become active citizens within this country to contribute to its future and its vibrancy. So that, I think, is in the spirit of Santa Ana, who we are and what we stand for, and that's what I would request that staff help us to be able to put together, and I believe some of my colleagues may have some additional comments to that effect. With that, thank you all for what you do, and have a great evening.
Councilor Sarmiento, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I want to thank staff for all the hard work they did tonight, and it looks like we may be out of here by 8 o'clock, so applause to all of you. And I wonder why that happened. No, just kidding. We won't say anything, but no. I do want to echo some of the council members' comments to our left that, you know, right now I was just sent a photograph, and there's about 500 or 600 people that are gathered in the intersection of 4th and Main right now who were very, very upset, as I was when I heard the news this morning that the DACA program was being rescinded. For me, this isn't a shock, and I'm sure for many people it isn't a shock, because it's just a very, very sad thought to think that we have a president that in almost a couple of weeks will pardon a convicted criminal who publicly racially profiled Latinos in Arizona, and now is intent on banning a program that really does celebrate the hard work and what an immigrant country has to offer, which is what we are. And we have some of the best and brightest in that program. Approximately 800,000 children and families are going to be affected, and about 100,000 of those live here in Southern California, and I'm sure that in Santa Ana we have plenty. These are our friends, these are our family members, these are folks that we've grown up with, people that have gone to school with us and go to school with our children. And it just is, it's appalling to see that the administration has, on the one hand criticized this executive order granting DACA, and in the same breath will issue their own executive orders to impose a ban on Muslims that travel, to ban transgender individuals from participating in the military. So it speaks from both sides of its mouth, and unfortunately it just loses all credibility by folks all over the world. So for us, though, because it's such a local issue, I do want to support what the council member mentioned. I think that what he said was to, in one element, is to condemn the rescission of DACA, and in the same, and maybe as a second element, urge Congress to act and adopt, some sort of relief, immigration reform. They haven't done anything for years. I don't have a lot of hope that they will, but nonetheless, I think that we can't be silent, because silence is acquiescence. And unfortunately, again, we have a community that we can't turn our back on. We've done many things to try to protect it and shield it, and we'll continue to do that. And I think this is one more way that we can show our support and our abiding protection to folks that, again, have come here to try to fulfill the American dream. And it was funny. I was, I have students who I've mentored who are DACA students who are in law school, who are receiving their PhDs, and they're from Santa Ana. And right now they're very fearful. They don't know what they're going to do and what their families are going to do once this program completely ends. So with that, I don't know, Madam City Attorney, if that has to be an 85A. Can it be a 65A based upon council direction if there's three of us at least mentioning this? It might be maybe a better way to bring it. That way you can put it together with a staff report and an RFCA, and we can just move it when it comes before us.
I believe this would fall within your policy of an item that's related to your legislative platform that can come from the city manager's office as a 65A item.
Is that acceptable with you, council member?
Absolutely. Make sure more than three say that, and I think that's fine.
Thank you. And with that, I'll say good night.
All right. So you've got at least four people up here from what I can tell.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I had some other announcements tonight as well, but this morning when I saw that decision come down, quite frankly, it shook me, and I thought it was a little bit of cowardness for the president not to stand before the cameras and take questions and make the announcement himself, and instead sent up Jeff Sessions up there to make the announcement and not to take any questions on this. I think our leaders choose to represent and work for us, and they should always have the, we should always have the opportunity to ask questions and allow them to respond. But I agree with Councilmember Sarmiento that how could you not be hypocritical when you enact your own push towards the ban, and then at the same time say, "Oh, but it's not our job to create laws. Our that's Congress's job." The fact is that this could have gone all the way up to the Supreme Court, and it could have been something that the courts could have decided. But this is political, and this is just another position on what this administration is trying to do when they talk about making America great. Let's really be honest about what it is, and that is not to support people of color. And unfortunately, these individuals who have come here, they didn't come here because they chose to come here. They came here because their parents brought them. They know no other country but our own. They fight in our military. They serve as police officers. They serve as first responders. And for them, for our president to just talk in one breath and say that he supports law enforcement, but not this part of law enforcement, is an absolute slap in the face. I want to take it a step further. I want to ask all of our organizations here within our city infrastructure. I want to ask our SEIU, I want to ask our Police Officers Association to join us in this venture and to say with one voice that we support these DACA individuals that have been working for our community that are not criminals, because they're here and they're studying and they're working and they're serving a great, they're giving us a great service here in the city of Santa Ana. More importantly, they're taxpayers as well. So thank you, Councilmember Benavides. Doesn't surprise me that you bring this up, because you've been a pioneer in assuring that we continue to support those that are most vulnerable in our community. And with that, I say good night, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. And with that, I think I know I called Alex Vega earlier, but you weren't here, so come up and speak now, Alex. No, you had a card. And I called the card. Come on, speak fast.
I'm sorry, and let me tell you, today is a very special day for me. That's Ashley's birthday. And I've been working in as a family therapy, you know, and I've been through a lot. And my family's been very supportive, all my kids. And they told me, and we talk about it, and I have to say I'm sorry to Sarmiento and Dinajero and everybody, because they said it's a new beginning. And I believe, because they supported me a lot, because I do not communicate the things that happened to me. So I got it out, yes, publicly, and it's a therapy that I've been doing, and I've been seeing the doctor. So, and I can see life without Michelle. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm going to continue this meeting, I believe, Madam Clerk, till the 18th of September. Did we say what time in the morning?
9:30.
All right, so with that, that's what we're going to do. We'll continue to 9:30 in the morning, September 18th. And with that, this portion of this meeting is adjourned.